A quick disclaimer before we get into it, I do not have all the facts. And obviously, not every single detail is here. Every statistic used is readily available information for anyone who wants to find it. And as always, this video is not intended to point fingers at certain groups or artists, nor start any fan wars. Each and every one of the artists mentioned here is simply a part of understanding the story of Dreamcatcher. If you love Dreamcatcher more than anything, or you couldn't care less about them, wonderful, that's all cool. I just ask that you leave your opinions about the members, your opinions about the fandom, and your opinions about any other artists mentioned here out of your consideration for the video. Dreamcatcher has something of a wild story. I'm not 100% sure, but I think they may or may not be caught up in some cosmic duel between two ancient gods, one who wants them to succeed, and one who wants to destroy them at all costs. Dreamcatcher is a girl group under Happy Face Entertainment, and they've been around since 2014. Kind of. The group has released 6 mini albums of reasonable success. Kind of. And they achieved their first win in September of 2019. Kind of. There's a lot to unpack about the history of Dreamcatcher, especially since they weren't even always Dreamcatcher. Over the years, the group has attracted a rather convoluted legacy, and when you look at it all laid out, there's something about Dreamcatcher that seems to be constantly dodging out of the way of danger. While there have been some touch-and-go moments regarding failure or even disbandment, Dreamcatcher seems to be doing some serious gymnastics to keep themselves in the game. Let's go back in time. August 9th, 2014. It all started in the summer of 2014, at the Oak Valley Summertime Festival. It's nighttime, and the stage is dark. Overhead, the intercom announces the next performance. Lights up. 5 girls in what can only be described as pure 2014 fashion take the stage under the name Minx. They perform 3 songs, all singing and dancing and smiling at the audience. They laugh, they wave, they joke around with the audience, and everyone seems to be having a good time. And there they go, off into the evening. September 15th, 2014. About a month later, a company known as Happy Face Entertainment announced that that's their new girl group, and they're set to debut that fall. Happy Face has had a decent number of different names, but for the ease of the story, I'll be referring to them as Happy Face Entertainment or just Happy Face. A couple of things to know about them before we get into the goods. Happy Face is not the richest company, but they're very much average. They're not as rich as Woolum or Stone, but they have enough money to give their artists comebacks and promotion when the board meetings say the omens are right. Happy Face was founded by a production duo called E-Tribe. You may recognize them as the producers of a little song called G. Happy Face aren't tiny, they aren't massive. Now back to the story. September 18th, 2014. Minx debuted as a 5-member girl group with their song, Why Did You Come to My Home? The song was pop influenced by hip-hop, and the music video followed a pretty standard 2014 concept, complete with the shorts and sweaters combo and thigh-high socks. Oh, and the random shots of girls in packaging. Remember when that was a thing? The group promoted their debut for over a month, finishing off in late October. Right now, Minx looked like a proper mid-2010s girl group, a Baby Girls Day Ursa star. They debuted with some pretty intense competition, including but not limited to Berry Good, La Boom, Mamamoo, Lovelies, and Red Velvet. The song didn't have a mini-album, which may or may not have been the bestest idea ever, as the song didn't quite manage to chart during the quarter. But being a debut, there was room to grow, and maybe fortune would favor the bold. July 1st, 2015. Or maybe not. 10 months later, Minx released their first mini-album, Love Shake, in July of 2015. The song and music video were all about summer romance, and the whole thing resembled an appeal to the many, many cutesy innocent concepts of summer girls looking for love. Now, we've talked about the 2015 scene before, but let's take another look at it. Oh My Girl debuted, Twice debuted, Red Velvet released their first full album, Girls' Generation released Lionheart. Both musically and visually, Love Shake didn't stick out from the pack. The whole thing was later described as a red ocean, meaning that there was absolutely no space for a concept like Minx's to stick out with everyone else in the industry. What Happy Face really wouldn't want right now is one of the most powerful groups in romance and dance genres to debut within 20 days of this comeback. So So also we have GFriend, one of the most powerful debuts of the year, occurring in the same month. Let's talk numbers. Eliminating the outliers, the average sale count for a girl group debut album in 2014 was around 3,780. In 2015, the average was roughly 5,060, with outliers eliminated. Minx's debut mini-album, Love Shake, made under 2,000 sales. That's under average for both 2015 and 2014. Not the worst, but not the best. Now, for a lot of groups, this is unfortunately a symbol of doom. It's much harder to keep yourself afloat without some form of album unless you're a big three group. By splitting off their first song from their first album by nearly a year, it looked like Minx's debut project might have caved in on itself. But the team over at Happy Face Entertainment had kind of an unconventional idea. In November of 2016, Happy Face announced that the group was going to re-debut under a new name. Happy Face pulled Minx from the shelf and got to work. New production design, new imagery, new sound, an entirely new instrument team was brought in. Super Bomb was brought in to produce new songs. Two new members, Gahyeon and Hundong, were added to the lineup. 2 months after the announcement was made, the artist formerly known as Minx debuted on January 13th, 2017. They weren't the mid-2010s cheerleaders of 2014 or the summer sweethearts of 2015. They were Dreamcatcher, a group drenched in horror and elegance with a rather Victorian spin on the supernatural. Main vocalist Sheehan described their new music as a style that takes inspiration from metal and rock, especially J-rock, and mixes some of their elements with a core of pop inspired by the mainstream. Happy Face themselves described the music as pop rock and rock-flavored girl pop. They debuted with the song Chase Me, and people immediately noticed the creativity of the group's hard-hitting style and old-world-inspired fashion. The group was establishing an anthology, where each girl represented a different nightmare. They weren't coming to you. As stated in their debut, you were coming to them. Dreamcatcher's debut single album, Nightmare, sold nearly twice as many copies as Love Shake, and Dreamcatcher debuted at number 20 on the Gaon album chart. Remember when we talked about fortune favoring the bold? This was bold. So bold that members of the groups themselves worried about the debut completely falling apart. However, it seemed the new style was just what the group needed to break through the waves of the market and start getting their name out there. That's taking New Year, New Me to a whole different level. In April, Dreamcatcher came back with Goodnight and their second single album, Fall Asleep in the Mirror. Once again, they were present with their metal and J-rock inspired sound and a creepy music video continuing the story of their last one, where they finally hopped on the good foot and killed that guy. Now all they really needed was a debut mini-album, preferably without the 10-month wait in between. At this point, it had already been around 4 months. Then 5, then 6, then... Whew, got it in just before 7. Dreamcatcher's first ever EP, titled Prequel, hit on July 27th with the A-track Fly High. Prequel hit like a grenade, peaking at 4 in Korea and selling over 11,000 copies. Remember what 2017 was for the industry at the time? Coming back wasn't just about returning to N Countdown or Music Bank, no no no. It was about getting on the damn plane and getting yourself a ticket to the Western music market. Boom. The album hit top 5 on the Billboard World Albums and went number 1 on the US iTunes K-pop chart. iTunes was still a thing at this point, if you're wondering. All in all, it was a pretty successful comeback. No, the girls weren't doing GFriend numbers or anywhere near the top 3, but the album performed well enough that in August, Happy Face announced that Dreamcatcher was getting a world tour. October 2017. Dreamcatcher had promoted almost exclusively as one unit since debut, likely to cement the theme of permanence and dedication to the new group project after the loss of Minx. It had been important during those first few years for them to appear as one solid team that wouldn't crack under the pressure of a demanding market. But now, with a slightly more stable grip on their group identity, they would need to flesh out their public images as individuals. Up until now, Dreamcatcher had largely stayed within their own bubble. In early October, Happy Face announced that Dreamcatcher and other Happy Face Entertainment artists such as D-Once and trainee group HNB would be joining the ranks of Mix 9, a survival show created and owned by YG Entertainment. The goal was to promote the group on widespread television, show off different sides of the group, and most importantly, give the public a taste of what Dreamcatcher members were like as individuals. Mix 9 was a sandbox for idols of various companies to show off not only their physical skills, visuals, and overall idol appeals, but also start promoting their own personalities. One of the key necessities to longevity in the industry is personal attachment. Much of the K-pop industry is designed to sell fans an idol, a person to get attached to. For a group like Dreamcatcher, advertising your own personalities is crucial to drawing in fans who might not know or otherwise care for your music. Fans are more likely to support a group they feel personally connected to and involved with, and this is extremely notable about girl groups in particular, which can sound pretty Machiavellian, but that's another can of worms. What it meant for Dreamcatcher was that the fans who enjoyed the group at large and the potential fans in the making could see the members' personalities and become more attached to them. It would give Dreamcatcher 7 more selling points. On top of that, a show like Mix 9 would, in theory, contribute to the message that Dreamcatcher were committed to impacting and succeeding in the market. By getting together idols from all over the industry to mingle with, compete against, and befriend each other, Mix 9 would, again, in theory, allow the members of Dreamcatcher to announce themselves as integrated players within the business, true competitors with skin in the game. Mix 9, like the Produce series, was a unique space for seeing idols outside of their own groups and allowing fans to get to know Dreamcatcher through groups they already loved. It appealed to many fans to see their idols friends with other idols, and it was helpful for idols to hone their promotion skills with other professionals. The show began in late October, and 4 members of Dreamcatcher, Jiyu, Shiyun, Yuhyun, and Dami, were there to compete against 94 other female idols. Talent-wise, it actually went pretty well. The members were recognized for their skills and development, each one receiving a rank of B or higher. Out of the 98 female participants, Yuhyun ranked in the top 9 during the showcase section, and Jiyu ranked at number 4 in episode 4 and number 7 in episode 5. Things were just starting to heat up. There were some great performances and some rather awesome moments from both the members of Dreamcatcher and the other idols they were working with. Win or lose, joining Mix 9 would only serve to help Dreamcatcher, as long as everything went according to plan. Well, about that. About 3/4 of the way into the show, Dreamcatcher's activities in Mix 9 came to a sudden halt. Practically out of nowhere, Dreamcatcher packed up their stuff and never returned. Happy Face released a statement saying they were officially pulling Dreamcatcher from the show, and instead, the 4 girls would rejoin the other members and participate in a tour through Brazil. It was a mixed bag, to say the least. While a tour would certainly bring in more money, there was a goldmine of potential publicity to be found in Mix 9. The members had accumulated decent rankings, and presumably the other industry benefits of joining Mix 9 would have strengthened as the competition continued. With just 6 episodes left, the decision seemed dicey. Until, well, I don't even need to tell you, do I? Mix 9 flatlined and everything went kaput. Upon finishing its run in December and announcing the winning group for debut, YG Entertainment canceled the entire project. Money went down the drain, months of time spent was now wasted, and YG's stock completely crashed. The companies and idols involved were screwed to high hell. For all intents and purposes, Dreamcatcher had basically sailed off the island just before the volcano exploded. Now, it's true there's no way Happy Face could have foreseen this. In fact, the idol who ranked highest in the entire show was Woo Jin-young, and 3 guesses what company he came from. It can't be stated enough how damaging the failure of Mix 9 was to its participants. Happy Face themselves proceeded to file a lawsuit against YG Entertainment for 10 million won. Later, Happy Face started to reveal a fuck ton of the underhanded actions done by YG during the course of the show, including but not limited to, YG unfairly extended contracts management period from 4 months to 3 years, which is extremely dangerous to smaller companies. They coerced Happy Face and their artists into agreeing to the new terms under the threat of cancellation, refused to fulfill their side of the agreements by covering fees such as transportation, training, clothes, and so on, and refused to pay any of the money that was owed to Happy Face for use of songs, trainees, and other material. Happy Face described the entire process as the overuse of power by a large entertainment agency with strong influence. Happy Face said this of the lawsuit: "More than to be compensated for all the damages we have received, this is a symbolic amount filed in our hopes that Korean popular culture will progress healthily without the overuse of power by large companies." In early 2019, we would find out that Happy Face withdrew this lawsuit, and there is definitely some speculation about what went down behind closed doors. Regardless, it was a disaster. Now let's get back to Dreamcatcher. In all honesty, it seemed that Dreamcatcher had miraculously dodged a bullet and were promoting their music internationally with the Fly High World Tour. By the power of sheer dumb luck, Dreamcatcher were out promoting in the world, and by the end of the year, the world was starting to pay attention. Chase Me was included in Billboard's Best K-Pop Songs of 2017 at number 19, and the group was crowned number 3 for Billboard's Best New K-Pop Acts. Things were starting to look up, and with that, the year wrapped. Kicking off 2018, Dreamcatcher celebrated their first anniversary with a fan meet. All 400 tickets sold out within minutes. While Dreamcatcher may have not been the biggest group in the world, their work in the past year had started to bring in dedicated fans. The celebration included the release of revamped material, new photo shoots, and the release of their fan-dedicated single, Full Moon. There was also an announcement of a March comeback. Time passed, they wrapped up their tour activities, and March arrived. They released their official name for the fan base, but no comeback. The month went on, no comeback. March ended, April began, and still, no comeback. Eventually, Happy Face announced that the album had been delayed, and fans were starting to get antsy. Dreamcatcher did not have a good history regarding album delays, and the last thing anyone wanted was a re-debut. April closed out with no sign of Dreamcatcher. Moving into May, Happy Face was utterly vacant. None of the members were making announcements, and the radio silence was starting to scare people. What the hell was going on? Finally, something gave way. An official announcement told the fans that Dreamcatcher were named ambassadors for Microsoft's blockchain security technology. And everyone said,
"Where's the album? We want the album."
Hey, what? Come on, this isn't a comeback. Where's the comeback? I thought we were getting a- And then Dreamcatcher dropped You and I. On May 10th, Dreamcatcher released their second album, Escape the Era. 6 songs, a budget update, and a hit on the charts. The comeback peaked at number 3 on the Gaon chart and debuted at number 7 on Billboard World Albums. The comeback centered around their iconic sound while also playing well to industry interests. The styling, choreography, and album maintained their unique traits while also imbuing them with elements of girl crush and EDM, two of the hottest dishes on the table at the moment. The comeback sparked heat in the industry, and the fanbase expanded into the mainstream. This was a good sign, because despite the touring projects Dreamcatcher had done the past year, they had yet to solidify a foothold across the ocean. You and I didn't draw blood in just the Korean market. Suddenly, the international fanbase was stoked from the embers, and Dreamcatcher rose from the ranks of cult favorite to commercial success. It was looking more and more like You and I was going to be the song that solidified Dreamcatcher for good. They had a really good week. And when I say a week, I do mean a week. For a full 7 days, it was Dreamcatcher's world. They received their first ever nomination for a win with You and I, and then to be fair, it didn't matter who you were shunted out the door when Love Yourself Tear dropped. Popularity disparity. Now we're gonna hit some confusion in the storyline. Sensing the growth of their popularity, the group went into something of a frenzy. Riding the high of You and I, they released a third mini album in September as part of their What comeback. And officially broke the 30,000 sales mark for a mini album. The album charted at number 2, which remains their highest position of all time as of the making of this video. They had a Japanese debut, and while they were met with some initial success, the activities in Japan remained largely unrealized. 2019. Regardless, they had another comeback on February 13th of 2019 with The End of Nightmare and its single, Peary. I I believe this is when Happy Face rebranded as Dreamcatcher Company, but some sources also say that it was a sub-label known as Dreamcatcher Company. Bless their hearts, I have no idea what they put in the water at Happy Face. And then off they went on yet another tour. Here's where things start to get Shakespearean, and I mean that in the bucket loads of pathetic fallacy way. And no, pathetic fallacy has nothing to do with the word pathetic, meaning desperate or depressing. Rather, everywhere Dreamcatcher went, things started to go wrong. Their concert in Jakarta was completely shut down for reasons that were never explained, there were scheduling conflicts and issues with tickets, and one of the theaters caught fire and burned down. Everything was going pear-shaped. After the tour, more Japanese promotions were released, but they went nowhere. In hopes of reigniting fan morale, the group opened applications for their official fan club that summer, but even then, little news came out of it and the whole affair slipped under the waves. While Dreamcatcher seemed to be anywhere and everywhere, and their comebacks were reaching decent upfront numbers, there was something off about their success. No matter how frequent the comebacks or how long the tours, Dreamcatcher couldn't seem to create a sense of longevity. The spaghetti wasn't sticking to the wall, and after a few weeks of initial success, Dreamcatcher's prominence would fade and take a backseat to everyone else in the industry. They seemed to be relying almost entirely on reappearance power, but in the grand scheme of things, it seemed that not many people outside the immediate fandom would notice that they went silent. Dreamcatcher's streak of good luck had short-circuited, and the members were rightfully exhausted. It was time to take a break, get some air, and come back when everyone was good and ready. In the meantime, Happy Face did what they do best, something unconventional. Happy Face started having board meetings with Vespa, an indie game developing company based in South Korea.
Hello. Yes, handshake. A handshake for you.
I like your tie.
I'm not wearing a tie. Have a handshake.
I heard the food would be provided.
I lied. Hello.
Your hands are very warm.
What if we kill one of the members and have her come back from the dead?
So here's my idea. Give Chiyu a big fucking sword.
Yes, exactly.
Brilliant.
I was thinking the same thing.
Fantastic.
That's all I've ever wanted.
Match made in heaven. On September 18th, we finally saw what all those board meetings have been about. Deja Vu was unlike anything Dreamcatcher had done before. The comeback was a collaboration with Vespa's mobile game King's Raid, which contributed to the expensive and dramatic visuals in the music video. That usual Dreamcatcher core was now combined with an emotional ballad, and it gave them their first charting song in the K-pop Hot 100. The album, Raid of Dream, hit number 3 and became their highest-selling album of all time. There was still one milestone that Dreamcatcher and their fandom had yet to crack, a first win on a music show. They'd come close in the past year, but hadn't quite managed to snag one. With the emerging success of Deja Vu, they might have their shot. Deja Vu was nominated for a win by SBS's music show, The Show, and many fans crossed their fingers in hopes that Dreamcatcher would take home their first win. That night...
먼저 사전에 집계된 음원 음반 점수입니다.
동영상과 전문가 팬 사전 투표 점수입니다.
여기에 생방송 중 집계된 실시간 앱 투표 점수를 합친 결과 더쇼 트위스의 주인공은
에버글로우 축하합니다!
The winner of the night was Everglow, taking home their first ever win. I'm gonna label this entire section alleged. There are details that can't be confirmed about certain parts of this issue, and there are so many different parts to what happened, and a lot of it is loosely translated from Korean into English. I encourage you to do your own research and come to your own conclusions. Anyway, on to what happened as best as I could research. Just a little while after the show announced its winner, fans and non-fans of Dreamcatcher began speaking out against the final scores, claiming miscalculation and even fraudulent behavior. So, there's a lot of controversy surrounding these numbers here. After the controversy gained some traction, a few fans started to claim that these numbers were already confirmed accurate and that the controversy was based on lies. As of now, there is absolutely no confirmation on any website in any language from any source that these numbers are accurate. Yes, if you add these numbers straight down, you do get 7,861 and 7,850. However, the addition of these numbers isn't what the outrage was about. It's that these numbers allegedly should have never existed like this to begin with, and that the calculation that was done to create them was fudged. So what went wrong? I'm basically going to be summarizing several articles that broke down the calculation process, the faulty results, and why people were saying it could have been intentional skewing. All of this information is readily accessible. I encourage you to look at them. One of the primary articles I'm looking at is this one by XDoublestar, who, while not a website I'm deeply familiar with, provided a decent amount of verifiable information. I'm going to be paraphrasing a lot from them. Credit to the breakdown goes to XDoublestar. Basically, Row 2 is where fans claim things went wrong. According to XDoublestar, we can establish beyond reasonable doubt that wrongdoing took place. Basically, three major things happened here. The first is that several points were shaved off of Dreamcatcher's YouTube score. Here is the viewer board of the show. Based on the show's own data, the score Dreamcatcher should have received was 1,472 points, higher than what they were actually given. Which means the show had data that gave one result, and yet somehow another number showed up. But the second thing happened in the category Expert Preferences. What is Expert Preferences? It's basically a category where the broadcast can award points to groups based on what they claim are preferences of experts. But this category has long been disputed by practically every fandom in the industry and even some companies, and is largely considered a place where shows just skew points to favor certain groups. In this episode of the show, CLC and Everglow both received full scores of 1,500 points for expert preference, and Dreamcatcher received a zero, which came as a shock to some people. But even with a zero, Dreamcatcher still would have won. In order for Dreamcatcher to receive the lower final score that they did, the experts had to have given them less than the minimum amount of zero and then masked it by announcing zero. Here's how that works, and again, these are all just claims as far as I know. Let's say that all the other data the show published in this section, except for expert preferences, was completely accurate. Now, let's remember that the minimum score for expert preference is apparently zero. When you calculate the full score giving Dreamcatcher an absolute zero in expert preferences, their final score for this section is 1,972 points. But the final score that the show released for Dreamcatcher was 1,850, 122 points below the possible minimum score. How did the show give them a score over 100 points below the minimum? Fans are saying that they gave Dreamcatcher negative points in this category. Allegedly, Dreamcatcher was given negative points in a category where you can't get negative points, which would mean that their score was deliberately subtracted. Dreamcatcher would have been given a false score on behalf of the show, and if these weren't simple computer errors, this would be cheating. Several fans and non-fans alike recalculated the scores using the minimum possible of 1,472 points, and based on the results, even if Dreamcatcher had scored an actual zero in expert preference, which again is absurd to begin with, they still would have beaten Everglow for first place. This led many fans to conclude that the show fudged Dreamcatcher's score and even subtracted points from it so that they could edge them in just under Everglow. If this is what happened, subtracting points from a group's score is tampering with a group's ability to win, and that directly impacts a group's success in the industry. So it's not really a surprise that some fans were disappointed and untrustworthy after the strange results were posted. Now, it's time to remember that this is not, under any circumstances, Everglow's fault. Everglow as a group had absolutely nothing to do with the way the show's scores were calculated, and no one can deny that they are a monster rookie group with tons of support. In the end, this is just as much a blow to Everglow as it is to Dreamcatcher. Everglow worked extremely hard to get where they are, and the last thing they'd want is a fraudulent first win, especially regarding all the heated tensions around rigging right now. And of course, this is not the first time a music show has given a win to the wrong group. In May of 2016, KBS's Music Bank gave first place to AOA for Good Luck, when the actual win belonged twice for Cheer Up. In May of 2019, Mnet's M Countdown gave first place to New East for Bet Bet, when the win really belonged to Oh My Girl for The Fifth Season. Something about the month of May apparently throws everyone's math skills out the window. The difference, of course, is that these shows both made official and public announcements about the mistakes and corrected the math as well as the true holder of the win. As of the making of this video, SBS and the show have made no such announcement. In fact, the only acknowledgement the show gave to the controversy were public tweets that seemed to passive-aggressively mock the group and the fans for the loss of the first win. And that was that for 2019. 2020. So what's up with Dreamcatcher now? Based on sheer numbers alone, Dreamcatcher is a decently successful group. Their continued sales presence puts them just under Lovely's, AOA, and Idol. Given their commercial sales and consistent comeback rate, I feel comfortable saying that they're not going anywhere anytime soon. It could be that this underrated narrative comes from a lack of blockbuster success internationally or top three status, and as such causes them to fall into the shadows in the eyes of many international fans. It could also be, and this is my personal hypothesis, that many of the struggles Dreamcatcher has gone through point out a distinct attempt by shadier parts of the industry to stifle the growth of an unconventional group. The industry thrives on convention, unfortunately, and deviations from the norm are often denied, sabotaged, or shut down entirely. And yet, despite all that, Dreamcatcher has survived to today. Dreamcatcher are something of an utter fascination. Ever since they first appeared as Minx, they have been doing some serious parkour to keep in the game, rolling, flipping, and flat out vaulting over Disbandment like they're in the goddamn Olympics. It's pretty damn impressive, I think. So here's to you, Dreamcatcher. Right now, you might be K-pop's Leonardo DiCaprio, but you are by far some of the most unkillable girls in the game. Though I still have questions as to what you did to that one guy. Dreamcatcher have announced a Japanese comeback this upcoming March, and let's hope that both means actual March and more success in Japan. Go get 'em, girls. That's all from me this time. Best of luck to Dreamcatcher, and I'll catch you guys later.